been afraid.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Eternal Midnight. I'm Chad. I'm here with Santino.
What's up, guys?
And Ken.
What's going on, everyone?
All right, so we are here for the bookends, the spin-offs. What do we want to call these for the Rocky series?
I guess it's like the anthology, right? I mean, like, it's not a continuation. It's not any more Rocky story, because Rocky story wrapped
I'd
up.
I'd say it's a little more Rocky story maybe in Creed 1, not so much Creed 2.
Nah.
I'd call it the reboot.
Yeah, because they're kind of kickstarting things again, kind of kickstarting things off. Same universe, but they're getting things going, but in a new direction.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a different name for Creed and Creed 2. It's everything the Star Wars sequels should have been. And I'll explain why.
Wish they could have been.
Nothing can stop you from attacking the Star Wars sequels.
They're it's open season. It'll always be open season for those movies. So yeah, if you can't tell, guys, we're talking Creed and Creed 2 today. So let's dive right into it, because Santino, I knew you were going to like these. I didn't know you were gonna love this movie as much as you did.
Oh man, holy shit. I love Creed 1 and Creed 2. These are like, wow. Oh my gosh. It blows my mind, because, like, okay, so in what I said earlier, Creed is essentially like everything that the Star Wars sequel should have been, because it does proper writing of reintroducing a character that you haven't seen in a while. And like the way they reintroduce Rocky back into this modern world is amazing, and I love how they did it. Like Rocky's kind of down on his luck, you know. He has cancer. Polly's dead. Adrian's dead. Mickey's dead. Apollo's dead. And he just kind of wants to die. Like, he just kind of wants, like, you know, if I break, I'm not gonna fix it, and I just want to go out and die. But then here comes Adonis Creed, who gives back life into him, and you know, he's training him, and it's like, it's so good, because like at the moment of like Rocky, like at his lowest, Adonis Creed comes back and gives Rocky life. And Rocky is this expert who knows the fight, who knows the battle, who knows the ring, and he's just teaching Adonis Creed everything he knows. This is like amazing. I love it. I love it so much. Creed is amazing. Mm-hmm. First Creed is amazing. Sorry, yeah. Opening monologue done, but yeah. I mean, like, what did you guys think? I mean, like, you're the Rocky experts here. I'm like the beginner, and I loved it. So
yeah. Like I said before, when I saw Rocky Balboa in theaters, I was like, oh, well, I have to see this. It's the only chance I'll ever get to see a Rocky movie in theaters. Little did I know this would come along 9 years later. And the first Creed for me is the perfect passing of the torch movie. I'll get in and bash the Star Wars sequels a little more. You know, like, those tried to pass the torch from Luke on to Rey. It could have been done better, but this just passed the torch perfectly. Adonis Creed, I love as a character. I will say this, in Rocky 2, we see Apollo has two kids who are nowhere to be seen now. So that's a question I have. They're gone. Probably off doing their own thing, but either way. I mean, pretty much everything Santino said, just the emotional weight we get to Rocky getting sick and Adonis wanting to prove himself, and just like, I mean, just sort of jump into the end. But when he says to Rocky, hey, let me prove it. He's like, prove what? That I'm not a mistake.
Oh, shit.
That hits me hard.
And the way he said, like, you're going to knock this guy out. You're going to fight. Because
you're a Creed and I love you.
Oh, shit.
And then he gets up and the Rocky theme plays.
Tearing up, dude. I was like, what is this? Like, how is this?
Yeah.
How am I having like emotions in a fucking spin-off of Rocky? I'm like, why? But like,
My god, none of them disappoint you. None of them. but yeah, perfect passing of the torch movie. Everything Santino said, it's fantastic.
I mean, yeah. You go first, Chad.
I mean, yeah, you guys basically covered all of it. I mean, it's one of those things that just came out of nowhere. And I remember my buddy Dave was like, hey, there's this movie called Creed coming out. You want to go see it? I'm like, I don't. And again, I still wasn't like, I'd heard of Rocky, but it's like, I just heard of Rocky. You know, I hadn't seen all the movies in a long time. I'm like, Creed, that sounds familiar. I'm like, wasn't that the guy he fought in the first one? I'm like, is this a prequel or something? He's like, no, it's a sequel. So it's like, I went in blind. Like, I purposely didn't watch any of the trailers. And I was just blown away. Because I was just like, I was like, this is how you get, like, the next generation going. Like, this is basically, like... It had that same feeling as if Rocky had been a sequel to like a Mickey series or something, where it's I've actually heard rumors that there's been talks that they want to do a Mickey series, and I'm like, it would be cool, but it would take someone extremely talented Notice whenever they do like movies that take place like in olden times, they always mix in too much like modern ways of people talking. And it's like, if they did a Mickey series, be like, I don't think people in the 30s spoke that way. But hey, it would still be cool to see, I think. I think that would be interesting. So, and this one I thought did it perfect with, and the one thing I do, like you said about Marion Creed taking in Donnie, where are the other kids? I want to know, at what point did Apollo cheat on her to have Adonis? Was it obviously it was before Rocky IV, but it's like I still love the movie. This is just a nitpick. I almost don't like it because it's almost like, wow, way to make Apollo look like a piece of shit towards his wife now too.
I did think that.
I mean, like, I don't condone affairs at all. I really really don't, but like, I kind of saw it as maybe it's like one of his like past flings. Like, he did it.
But with the age Donnie was at, it had to have been almost right before Rocky IV.
Yeah, I assume.
Where it's like, I thought he'd learned everything from Rocky 1, 2, and 3 and had kind of, we'll say, matured. So, yeah, I don't want to dwell on it too long because it is a nitpick, but I just was like, kind of like, damn, what a middle finger to that character and all the development he went through.
Right.
It's not really like, you know, the Emperor comes back and everything he's done is undone. But like, it's a birth timeline. I don't think it's really that big a deal. But yeah, okay.
Not. It's just one of those things where I was just like, kind of like, wow, didn't think he was... I would have thought he was maybe capable. I don't know. He still seemed like a down-to-earth family man. Just, he took his sport extremely competitive. But that's what it is. Well, moving past that, moving back onto the movie as it is. Like you said, having Rocky in it was, like, perfect. Because obviously this movie would not have really worked without Rocky. We'll see how things go moving forward, which we'll cover at the end of Rocky 2. But... yeah, like seeing Rocky like unloading the vegetable truck or the produce truck or whatever, and it's like, damn, now age has smacked this man. Like, if people were like, oh, Rocky Balboa, he's too old to fight, it's like, no, now he's too old to fight. Mm-hmm. I like how he says it when he first takes him to training, and Donnie is like, hey, man, I thought you were going to train me. And Rocky's like, I can't do this shit anymore. He's like, I can't do it. He's like, I can watch you. He's like, I can teach you with my words and my eyes. He's like, but I can't do this physical stuff anymore.
Yeah. He's too, like, old. And I can tell, it reminded me a bit of, like, Logan, like, from 2017. Like, he's just too old. Like, his claws don't come out anymore. And he's just like, he struggles to physically walk, but, like, you can tell that this guy has the fire still in him, and like, he can still teach Adonis. Mm-hmm. And Adonis is in his prime. Like, this guy, like, he has his whole life ahead of him. And like, you know, seeing that, you know, with the strength and power of Adonis and the knowledge of Rocky and how long he's been in the game, like, this guy's gonna be unstoppable. Like, and I honestly love what Bianca says. You know, Bianca, the girlfriend, or the Adrian of this new anthology series. I love what Bianca says, basically, like, you know, you are Apollo Creed's son, you know, so use the name, you know, fight the hero. And like, that's essentially what the movie is doing. Like, you know, you are Rocky Balboa's, like, essentially the kid of the Rocky franchise. So use the name of the characters, but fight the hero, be your own man. Don't, you know, shamelessly do a cash grab of what you did before. So, I mean, like, this is amazing. I mean, the director, Ryan Coogler, and he wrote a movie where it didn't have to rely on the older movies, and but in fact, it homage to it, and that's awesome. But it pays homage, but also writing its own story. I mean, Adonis is not Rocky 2.0. He's his own man. I mean, like, I don't think. I mean, like, Adonis is certainly more hot-headed than Rocky. It's like Rocky's like a. I rewatched the original Rocky just like right now, and Rocky's a very peaceful guy. Like, he doesn't. He's humble, but Adonis is like he's a hothead, you know. But like, but you know, he still has compassion, and that's awesome, and it's amazing. I really love what he's done.
And it's so funny because Ryan Coogler like approached Sylvester Stallone with the script, and Stallone, like, I hear he originally was sort of hesitant towards it. He's just like, you know what, I've done everything I can with that character, I'm sort of done with it. But then, yeah, much like Rocky passes the torch to Adonis, this is very much a passing of the torch to, you know, this new generation of filmmakers that can bring new life to your franchise. One thing I want to mention is I love the familial bond that I feel like Donnie immediately feels with Rocky, because he's immediately calling him uncle, and Balboa is just a little like he's a little hesitant at first.
Yeah.
But I just think that's awesome. Real quick, I do want to talk about Michael B. Jordan's performance, because he is just so damn good in this movie. He is. I mean, I think it was a crime that Stallone didn't win the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor. I think it's a crime that Michael B. Jordan wasn't nominated for an Oscar.
The funny thing is, I think I said this to you, Santino. This movie, to me, saved Michael B. Jordan's career. Because this came out, don't forget, the same year as Fantastic Four.
And if
Creed had not come out that year, I think he would have been done. So it's like he lucked out that basically, like, as soon as filming for Fantastic Four was over, he jumped to this. If this had been like a project like a year later, I bet you he wouldn't have been in it. They would have been like, nope, scrap this kid, get somebody else, because this kid, he's not going to be marketable anymore. People would just tie him with Fantastic Four. And thankfully, this was as damn good as it was, and this movie like saved him.
I mean, you look at like Miles Teller and Kate Mara. They became non-existent after Fantastic Four, and they were like pretty big.
They're in the indie circuit now, I think. That's it. I think like Fantastic Four killed their mainstream Hollywood ambitions.
Exactly, but like Michael B. Jordan, he
I mean, look, he went from Fantastic Four to being the villain in some people's like favorite MCU film. I mean, that's a hell of a comeback.
Yeah, I mean, you can say like he died in Fantastic Four and he was like resurrected in Creed. Like he literally came back from the dead. And like because Donnie as a character is amazing. You know, he's the bastard son of Apollo Creed, and he wants to prove that he's his own man and he doesn't have to ride the coattails of the Creed name. Like, he can have his own victories, and that's just awesome right there. I mean, I don't think you can have a more compelling character arc in a Rocky movie than that. Because that's just cool. I did like Bianca as a character, Tessa Thompson. Like, I did like the fact that she was going through her own struggles of, like, you know.
That was genius, adding that in there, I thought.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm slowly going deaf, and like, but I want to sing. It's like, they find each other at a time where they need each other, and that's just amazing.
And like, that adds... I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, sorry, you go first.
I was just going to say, and that adds more character development to her than I feel like Adrian had in the first movie.
I mean, like, Adrian grows as a character. Like, we haven't seen Bianca's, like, fully done. Like, I can't judge. Like, if you say Adrian or Bianca, like, right now, it's like, Adrian. Because, like, Adrian had, like, what, 5 movies?
Right.
And Bianca's only had 2. So I really can't judge.
Right.
But, and having the like slowly having it slowly happen is gonna add, because as long as the Creed movies keep going, which I do and don't hope they keep going, because I don't want it to get so far that it gets stale, but at the same time, it's like I almost want to hit the film where we see Bianca deaf, because that's going to add an even another challenge to even Donnie's life with what's already been added on once we hit Creed 2 with his daughter. So it's like, and I think that'll add more to her character as well, because then at that point we'll have to see her being able to cope with not being able to do the venues anymore. Maybe she'll still be able to record and sing, possibly, but she's not going to be able to do her passion of music festivals, venues, tours, any of that. So it'll add more character to more depth to her character.
And it can add some tension between her and Donnie because he gets to keep doing what he loves.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, that genius writing, adding something like that.
Absolutely.
I
mean,
I don't want it to become stale. Like, if you're going to make more Creed movies, make it like the Mission Impossible movies where, like, you have a story and you have to tell it well and tell it right. And real quick, since we haven't mentioned it, the fights in this first movie are insane.
Main fight, one continuous shot. Yep. That is such talented filmmaking, being able to do and pull off something like that. And major props to the actors, because think how many takes and practices they had to do for something like that.
I was watching, I cannot tell where they could have, like, you know, put like a cut there or, you know, cut there. Like it was all one take, and it was all well done. It was all well, you know, directed. And I guess if I had to like really, you know, put a negative in this, it's like the pretty Ricky Conlon wasn't exactly a good antagonist. Like, he really was just a weaker one. I prefer Drago, Mr. T, what's his face from Balboa? I forgot his name, but like I prefer
Tommy Gunn.
Mason Dixon.
Oh, Mason Dixon.
Yeah, Mason. Yeah, I prefer him more than. Then Conlon, because Conlon's just like, I'm a dick and I'm gonna no real character development there. I was like, I'm a dick. Yeah. Like, basically he was just
still, I give him credit though. He still was a damn good sport at the end. And what he said to Donnie after he beat him, I thought was it was one of those things he didn't need to say it, but he still did. Looking at him going, you're the future of this sport right here. I was like, again, I was like, he didn't need to say it. So it's like, it's almost like he's a dick and he knows it and he plays it up on purpose, but the guy still was possibly a good man deep down.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, real quick, I just felt like Conlon was there to be like, to have like a final boss for Creed to fight.
I can see that.
Yeah, if you feel like there was like we need a final antagonist, and like, who are we gonna fight? We had an awesome one take shot, like, but that was like in the middle of the movie. Like, who are we gonna fight now? Like, let's just have a big hulking muscular guy and, like, you know, we'll see what happens. I mean, I guess so, but I'll give it this, I did like his entrance song. That was amazing. Shit, like, this guy's intimidating. Like, he was a weaker antagonist, and like, the only antagonist weaker than Conlon was Tommy Gunn, and that was from Rocky V. So yeah, how about you, Kevin? Like, did you like, you know, the fights in this movie or what?
Oh, yeah, the fights, I like you guys said, that first fight, that's just one continuous tracking shot, I really loved. The final fight, I mean, yeah, Conlon's doesn't get the most development of most of the antagonists, but, the fight itself is just thrilling to watch. I think it's not as believable as the Rocky Balboa fight. It seemed a little more choreographed, but I mean, it's still just a ton of fun to watch. And just that moment when Creed, like, first delivers a good hook onto Conlon and he's got a cut on the side of his face, and then he just has that look on his face like, oh shit, okay, this is gonna be for real now. One thing I do want to mention, the Creed theme, which is sort of a takeoff of the classic Rocky theme, because it has the lines "gonna fly," but it's just, but it's still a different tune. I really love the Creed theme.
I thought all of the music in both Creed 1 and 2 were great. Mm-hmm. I think I like Creed 2's soundtrack better, and I like some of the songs in that one better. But yeah. This one, again, this just did such a good job, I thought, of mixing like some of like the old and new. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like when you know, Creed's going into the final match and or the final round, he's like blind in one eye because his eyelid is just swollen and everything, and they're like, I mean, very risky thing to do when the guy's telling them, how many fingers am I holding up, and they like tap him on the back of his neck to tell him how many so he can keep going. Yeah. Risky thing to do, but it's cool that they did that for him. But yeah.
I almost wish they'd saved that for Creed 2.
Yeah.
I almost wish they had for the fight against Victor.
Yeah.
But when Creed, no, when Rocky tells him, when he says, like, you're going to do this, and, you know, you taught me how to fight again, and you're going to fight, and you're going to go out, and you're going to beat the shit out of this guy. You know why? Because you're a Creed, and I love you. And then he gets up, and the classic Rocky tune just swells. Yeah. I'm like, yes!
Yes! Shit! I was like, oh, perfect. That's how you do pay homage, and at the same time, mm-hmm. Sorry, that's just amazing.
Absolutely.
And speaking of Rocky, let's talk about him for maybe a minute or two, just because I feel like we covered him for like a minute right at the beginning.
Yeah.
But it's like, I thought his journey that they gave him was damn good in this one. Like that, when he was told he had the cancer, he's just like, mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. He's just like, everybody I know, everybody's gone. He's like, there's no, and it's like that, like, and what, when he looked at Donnie and was like, you know, we're not family. I was like, oh shit. I'm like,
this kid
looks up to you as a father figure. And what you just said was like a knife in his heart saying that.
Absolutely. And then when Donnie gets arrested for getting into the fight with that guy, and then Rocky comes to bail him out, and then he just like unloads on him, and he's like, get your sick ass out of here.
Yeah.
I'm just like, oh, that's not okay.
Yeah.
It was rough. Cause it's like, just what Rocky was going through in this. Here's something I was wondering also that I don't understand from a writing perspective. So Rocky Balboa, we covered the whole father son not connecting like they did, and then they fixed it. But then they just hit the reset button in this one again, where Rocky's like, "Oh yeah, my kid moved away," and we don't talk anymore. It's like, why did you include that?
Yeah, I agree, but the way that comes full circle in Creed 2, I really like, and I'll say some things about that.
It was, but I just wonder, like, what mm-hmm. what happened after they fixed things in Rocky Balboa to suddenly cause it to happen basically the exact same way again?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's been answered yet, and I think after Creed 2, I don't think they're ever going to touch on it, which, it's fine, it's not that big a deal. It's just kind of one of those things where it's like, but we just fixed their relationship, and now it's broken again? Okay. I guess mm-hmm. it was to get Robert out of the movie? And you know what? Yeah. I was hoping for some kind of cameo of Marie and Steps in this movie, maybe still working at the restaurant or something. But they were just, I mean, it's obviously not Rocky's world's, it's not Rocky's story anymore. So we don't need mm-hmm. all the carryovers, but it was almost like, I wanted maybe a cameo. Like, what happened? Marie was working at the restaurant. Now she's gone. We didn't need to see like Rocky hanging out with them or anything, but it's like, where'd they go? Damn it.
Yeah. Yeah. Sucks that, like they some of the stuff that I liked in Balboa was just like not here. But I did like the reveal that Rocky reveals that Apollo Creed won the third hidden fight. I was like, oh shit.
Yep.
Oh shit. I was like, okay. All right. So there's some great continuity in here, like more than the Star Wars sequel. I was like, all right, so there's
Again, another franchise that pays attention to its past and knows that they have to pay attention to their past to make the future work in these movies, mm-hmm. and it's damn smart. Do we got anything else anybody would like to cover for Creed?
Yeah, I want to move on to the better sequel.
Oof.
Ken?
No, I think I've generally gotten everything out that I wanted to.
Yeah, Creed, great start. Came almost like the first Rocky. Came out of nowhere. Probably nobody thought this was going to be as good as it was. And mm-hmm. it blew me away watching it in theaters. I actually saw it twice. I think I see it twice or three times in theaters. I think twice. And I loved it. So I was like extremely happy when they announced they were doing a Creed 2. And I will always remember when that first trailer dropped and we saw Ivan Drago, I was like, oh shit. I was like, this is the kind of sequel people look forward to when it comes to these kinds of movies. And then seeing just that hulking mass of his son.
Oh my God.
Ooh. I was actually talking with my buddy Dave yesterday. We were just talking about these movies while we were doing some yard work here. And he brought up a good point. He's like, yeah, Victor and Donnie would never face each other. He's like, those two aren't don't weigh anything near the same amount.
Yeah, I was watching this movie. Not even the same weight class.
Not even close. Dude is a tank.
And honestly, I was thinking back about it, about even Rocky IV. I'm like, Drago probably had 30, 40 pounds on Rocky in that, so they wouldn't have faced each other either.
Yeah.
But that also wasn't for the title, but that's whatever. But yeah, it was, again, silly little nitpick, but it's just like, no, Donnie and Victor would never face each other.
But dude, this movie was nuts. I love it.
Oh, yeah.
I keep saying it. This one took me by surprise how much I loved it when I saw it in theaters. And it had been a while since I watched it. And when I rewatched this the other night, it catapulted up in my ratings for how much I love this movie.
It's funny because I've been watching all the Rocky movies online. And then when I looked at the HBO hits and I was like, there's a weekly schedule. And I saw Creed 2 this week. I was like, I gotta watch it on the TV. So I woke up early in the morning. I popped it in, and I was like, and dude, it blew me away, how good this movie was. I love Creed 2. Creed 2 it made Rocky 4 super relevant. And
yeah,
it made it improved. And I was like, when I saw, Drago talking with Rocky in the restaurant, mm-hmm. That was, wow, are they actually making me feel bad for him? I'm like, he murdered Creed. I'm here feeling bad about it. It's Drago was dishonored and he lost.
He was kicked out of his country, essentially. What country was he living in?
Ukraine.
He was living in Ukraine, doing nothing. His son was working in a warehouse
worker,
or something.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah. And I'm like, this guy went from a national symbol to an absolute nobody, exiled out of his own country because he lost. I'm like, and yeah, I'm sitting there. I'm like, this guy's a dick, but I felt bad. And is it just me? I can't be the only one who felt this. When I saw, that music was swelling when Rocky and Drago were going back and forth, and then Victor walked into the restaurant, I was like, are they going to, physically assault Rocky right now or something?
Afraid. Yeah.
I was afraid.
I was like, are one of them, are they going to, throw him around or punch him or something? I was like, uh-oh.
Yeah. Couple of things I do want to say on this. So, like you guys, I was surprised at how much I felt for the Drago family. Well, for Drago father and son. It was surprising. But at the same time, I do have to say, when he does have that scene where he says to Rocky, because of you, I lose everything, I feel bad for you. But at the same time, there is part of me that's just like, who the fuck are you to complain? You murdered a man.
Yeah.
And now and you're here to challenge his son.
Yeah. Oh, my God. And when they have that weigh-in, and jumping around here, but when they have that weigh-in and Ivan looks to Donnie and says, you're smaller than your father.
Ooh.
Oh, how fucking dare you?
Yeah,
exactly. Because the man who murdered him is sitting feet away from you, and he got in, aside from the only issues, he got in with his own country of being exiled because he lost the fight. He had no repercussions for killing Apollo.
Yeah. And I can tell from the way this was filmed and written, this is more of a Creed movie than a Rocky movie. Because Rocky's in it, but he really kind of takes a back seat.
They very fully much. Passed the torch, basically. Rocky had no... The only development Rocky had in this movie was the semi-relationship he had between him and Ivan with what happened in Rocky IV. But other than that, they finally moved to, this is fully Adonis's story at this point.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Exactly. And Creed was basically it was the transition point, and now it's we're going fully more into Donnie's story, which I love because Donnie is a very great character and I want to see more of him. And I do like seeing more of him.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate the fact that, we're not, in it making your own legacy and your own name in cinema, you can't always have Rocky with you as like as a failsafe to be like, oh no, no, watch a movie.
Yeah.
Rocky's here. Like, in the same way, like, you know, when Luke dies in Last Jedi, but they bring him back for Rise of Skywalker because no, he's back, you know, and like something like that, you know? It's the same thing. But like now it's like Rocky is taking a backseat, although he is still an important character. And mm-hmm. I think my favorite scene with Rocky in this movie was when they're talking, like Creed and Rocky are talking, and Creed says, "I want to take the fight with Drago," and Rocky's like, "You don't have my blessing this because this guy is dangerous and he has broken things in me that will never be fixed. It's not worth it."
I loved the way he delivered that mm-hmm. line. That yeah. man broke things in me that ain't never been fixed.
Which, yeah.
I
mean, which
that,
sort
like,
of
that line enough should put fear in anyone for somebody yeah. else. Like, yeah. holy shit. Dude,
and it's the first line.
I think you should fight him.
And it's the first line. And it's the first line that really made me sort of think, okay, they're finally calling some sort of attention to Rocky V. Because Balboa and Creed, they really ignored 5. Like, a lot of what happened in 5 just isn't brought up again. The mental health issues he had after fighting Drago. And this is him saying that is maybe just a little bit of a hint back to, yeah, I had issues after this fight.
Yeah, because like because you can tell, like, Drago was, like, the scariest opponent. Like, I mean, like, I still think that Mr. T, or what was his name again in Rocky III? Yeah, Clubber Lang was, like, the most aggressive, but Drago was the most dangerous. And when mm-hmm. Rocky says, like, you know, I don't want you taking this fight because, you know, you're young, you have a family, you have a wife, you're gonna have a kid. I don't think that you should be taking this fight because it's not worth it. It's not worth losing your life over this, man. And at that point, I was like, yeah, dude, I kind of agree. I don't want you fighting Victor Drago either because this guy's enormous and he's gonna kick your ass. And then like, and it happens, dude. Like the first fight.
That first fight.
Oh shit, dude, that was brutal.
Victor maybe got hit once or twice, but Victor walked away completely unscathed.
Yeah. Oh my god. And none of the Rocky movies had done this before, but getting like that POV shot of the punches coming at you,
mm-hmm.
very like really just made me flinch. And oh my god. Oh, and when he's down and Drago just like hooks him down, and you can see the ref is yelling stop.
Yeah.
And he
that was like, the only thing that saved him. And it's like, I thought that was a genius move because it was basically the opposite of Apollo versus Rocky in Rocky mm-hmm. 1, where it's like Apollo officially won, but he's like, I don't feel like I won. And it's the yeah. same thing here where it's like he got beaten down and he only maintained the title because of a technicality like that. And same thing. Yeah, he's like, I didn't win that fight. He's like, I lost.
Yeah. And
you can tell like this was like a humiliating moment for Donnie because like he mm-hmm. got beaten up in his hometown and he had a great hype song too. It was like Icon by Jaden Smith. Like he's walking in like, yeah, I'm gonna kick this guy ass. And like halfway through the first round, it's like, all right, he's fucked, dude. He's not gonna make it.
Like, oh my god. And when Rocky is watching from the restaurant and he's just yelling, stop the fight. It's like he can't
do anything because like yep. he's not there with him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's like it's almost a repeat of what happened with Apollo, and this time it's gonna be Donnie getting killed. Like, oh dude, I was like, oh shit, I'm feeling for Rocky right now. Like exactly, like there are not many emotional moments with Rocky as there were in the first Creed, but there are still like some great like I feel for Rocky right now, man. Like,
I think. Was it when they went to the desert training place that Rocky said it when he was like, I should have thrown in the towel and I like regret it every day or something like that?
Yeah.
And I mean, imagine like we briefly touched on it in Rocky IV, but imagine having that on your shoulders the rest of your life, knowing you could have saved a man's life. He might have been pissed at you for who knows how many years for stopping it. But it's like inside, if he had thrown the towel in Rocky IV, inside Apollo would have known, I'm glad he did it, but his pride never would have allowed him to admit it until further down the road. But imagine being Rocky living with that every day, knowing Apollo's dead because of his choice. And he's like now at that crossroads where he's like, I'm at the same spot I was at, except with his son, who could possibly have the exact same thing happen to him.
Absolutely.
And man, I mean, like, jumping a bit to the end, I love a parallelism of, like, I love the parallelism of Ivan Drago throwing in the towel to save his son. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, that's going to be more humiliating than actually dying in the ring for the Russians. But, like, Ivan Drago did it because, like, I don't want my son to die. I don't want my son to get, like, injured more.
And that, like, was the first time. And that was the first time. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So, yeah, you're saying.
And that's the first time, you know, we see just what all we had in four was just the stoic machine of a human being now has decided, you know what, no, my child's life is more important to me than the glory of Russia. And oh my god, and when it reaches that point where the tides sort of turn in the fight and Donnie knocks down Victor for like the second time, and then his mom just steps out and
I audibly
said in the movie theater, "You fucking bitch."
Yeah. I can understand turning her back on Ivan, maybe, but what an awful mother to turn her back on her son. Jeez, this is your flesh and blood, and you're just like, she views him same thing. She's like, this kid's just a tool. If he's a loser, I want nothing to do with him. I'm like, what a bitch.
Yeah, and I honestly was like, I was with Victor when he walked out on that dinner table thing. Like,
yo, 100%. Oh, yeah. These people don't care about you.
Get the fuck out of there. I don't think you should be there either.
Yeah, like, he's like, Dad, they don't care about us. We are a tool to them. And also, yeah, sort of jumping forward to the fight, that final time when he knocks down and you see Ivan start to walk away, at first you think, or at least I thought, he's walking out on his son. But then when he comes back with the towel,
I really was afraid he was going to. But then it was like, that was like the humanizing moment where I, like you said, Ivan was just like, forget it. My kid means more to me than these people who don't care about us. I'd rather live in like the slums of, I forget, you said they were in Ukraine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, I'd rather live in the slums of Ukraine with my kid than beg my way back into Mother Russia and not have him.
Yeah, and I also like that scene, like, at the very end, like, you see Ivan and Victor, they're running together, and you can tell that they're kind of happy with each other. Like, they're happy with their lives. It's like, you know what, we're outcasts, but at least we're a father and son, and yeah, you could, and like, yeah, you know, like, they humanized Drago, and I was like, that's amazing.
I gotta bring up, who directed this movie? What was the director's name?
This was Stephen Caple Jr.
Stephen Caple Jr., props to him, man, because, you know, Ryan Coogler was busy, you know, getting into the MCU. And so he had, I think, did Stephen Caple Jr., did he do something on the first Creed? I feel like he did. I could be wrong.
Let me bring it up. I don't believe so, though. No, I'm looking at his filmography. I don't see anything for the first Creed.
Okay, but he was maybe, you know, a friend or a protege of Ryan Coogler. Ryan Coogler said, you take this one. And my god, he did a damn good job.
Damn, good job.
Yeah, so props to Stephen Caple Jr. Also, fun thing, well, not so much fun, but interesting to my mind, this movie, just like the first Creed, came out on Thanksgiving. Personally, I think this movie would make a great, like, Father's Day release. Because you got Donnie becoming a father, him reconciling the legacy of his father, Ivan and Victor reconciling, and then at the very end you even got Rocky and Robert meeting up again.
Sweet moment. That was like, I that. And we haven't talked about it, but I love the development that Donnie gets in this movie a lot, because like he really wants to like take revenge, and like even his mom was like, you know, if you want to fight this man, it's your business, but don't pretend that this is not about your dad. And I was like,
yep.
She's speaking facts. I can't.
Absolutely.
I can't deny that. And when, and honestly, I love that sweet moment where he's about to propose to Bianca, and then Rocky's like, "How did you say you?" And then Rocky's like, "You know, there was this tiger, and he's kind of said it." And I was like, "Oh yeah, throwing it back to Rocky." Ass fantastic.
Oh my god. I would have loved like, also I just thought it would be totally out of place in this universe, but I just would have loved like I mean it'd be a horrible joke, but like if Donnie is just like, "Hey, you know what went on? Why did you let my dad die in the ring?" And what if Rocky was just like, "Look, kid, I didn't know what was going on. There was a robot in that movie. Things got wild." All right.
Bad joke. I don't think I would have put the seriousness in the movie. But like the scene that really made me cry, like I really felt like so bad for the characters. Like and I could tell I was invested. Was that scene in the hospital where they tested the baby's hearing? And it was none. They're like, oh shit.
And you can again, like, that was such good filmmaking of words were not needed. Everyone's just facial reactions was all it took to convey the story. And that is such a talent to be able to be like, we don't need words for this. Just show it. And Bianca looking at Donnie and the tear coming down. It was just that sold that whole scene for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, that's why in my opinion, I think Donnie goes through way more in here than what he does through like in Creed 1. Because like he was humiliated, he was beaten up, and like he's struggling like with his life, and then like he's physically in pain, and now his kid's deaf. And like when he's in that gym and he's punching the bag and he's like yelling.
Oh, yeah.
I felt it. Like, yeah, dude, I understand where you're coming from. I really do.
And then there's just a little bit of a chuckle moment when he picks up the baby. He's just like, it's all right, daddy's just being a bitch.
Yeah. The scene that made this movie for me was when Rocky comes back and trains Donnie, and they train in the desert. And like, these are
really- oh, yeah. Oh,
that music. Santino, you sent me that track the other day to listen to again. That was some incredible music.
Yeah, it's like orchestra, so good. And then rap, and then choir. It's like, oh my god! Like, I felt so pumped after. It was like, yes, 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 yes.
Also, one song. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. That's just it. I felt so hyped after like they were training, and like Creed was giving it his all. Like he had like weights around his ears, and he was like, and like he was getting hit in the stomach by Rocky. Rocky was like, Rocky, you could tell he had some strength because he was hitting Creed in the stomach. And Creed
with
was like,
tire.
Yeah.
This is after he got his ribs broken in the first fight.
Oh my god. Also, just a little moment that just made me cringe is when he's peeing blood.
Oh.
I was like, ugh. But I want to say, I just think it's cool that, you know, they're training in the desert. Sort of like a flip side of the Rocky IV training of being out in the tundra. Also, in terms of music, this is sort of out of nowhere, but the first trailer song, I've Got Royalty Inside My DNA.
Yeah.
That song just gets me pumped.
Yeah, I know. That's one of my favorites, Kendrick Lamar songs. DNA by Kendrick Lamar is amazing. Mm-hmm. But like, what did like ASAP Rocky's like running with like, you know, the orchestra cues up and then like it goes into rap, and then you can see like Donnie punched the bag, like, oh shit, like he's getting ready, and you can see Victor Drago, like he's also getting ready, and like,
oh my god,
I was so hyped. And then like I don't care what anyone says, that Donnie won the entrance song of the final like Creed fight with Tessa Thompson.
That song from Tessa Thompson was I Will Go to War. That was such a good song.
And they're coming in as a family, and that just adds so much power to it.
And then when Rocky said, "Remember why you're climbing these steps," I was like, Oh shit.
Yep.
That's so damn good. This movie is like, wow. I didn't even really think of negatives in it, because like it expands.
The negatives I've seen, I think some of the negatives I've seen are nitpicky. Some I've seen, they're like, oh, the movie was like predictable in some points, but it's like, but that's such a bad negative to have against a movie, especially when it's filled with such character development and building, where it's like, I could almost do the exact same thing with the first Creed. I could be like, it's just it's predictable. It's just a repeat of Rocky 1. It's like, yeah, but you're leaving out everything that makes these movies good, which is the character interactions, the character building, the depth. If that's not there, then yeah, you just have a shallow imitation. But I don't in any way see this as a shallow imitation of any of the other previous Rockies. Not in the slightest.
It's its own thing.
It's very formulaic. It's formulaic. But so are all the Rocky movies.
Almost all movies are formulaic in a way. The good guy wins. I mean, I could flip it around and say the same thing about, like, the MCU. Oh, look, they're all the same because the good guy wins at the end of all of them except for, like, two of them, maybe. It's like, okay, well, then I guess they all suck following the first Iron Man because they're predictable. Yeah, no, well, that's not what people focus on with those. That's not what you should be focusing on with this one.
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, it's a, you can tell, like, it's a bit predictable at some point, but it's about what the characters are going through, and, like, I didn't...
It's how they react to the predictability. It's about how they handle the situations they're put in. And, like, Donnie, like, we saw in, like, Rocky 5, those flashbacks Rocky was having of the fight against Ivan, where it's, like, you can see it was, like, messing with him. And I think they did the same in Balboa. And it's like, no, we didn't really get that in this one as much. This was just Donnie being like, I don't even know anymore. And then being brought back. And I love that scene when Rocky was like talking to him. He's like, what did he say? Wasn't it like, do you feel bad for your daughter or something? And he's like, hell no, I don't feel bad for her. And he's like, well, she ain't feeling bad for herself either.
Oh, yeah.
So he's like, dust yourself off and get back out there.
Yeah, exactly. It's really about the characters, and this movie has balls. It has balls to be like, you know, like, we're gonna bring Adonis down to his like lowest point in life, you know, beaten up, humiliated, one because of a technicality, and now his kid's dead. Like, it's all downhill. But you know what? And like, I love it, Rock, because, you know, if you want to like, be able to deal with pain, you gotta take the pain. And I was like,
oh yeah,
fantastic line right there. Can I just say, the fight between Drago and Creed, the final fight, is one of my favorite fights in the entire Rocky saga. The only fight that beats it, in my opinion, is the fight between Clubber Lang and Rocky at the very end of Rocky 3. In my opinion, like, that's a bigger one, but like this one's huge. And I love that. I love in the 12th round when I love how Rocky's coaching, like, take the full eight, you know, like, stay down.
Yeah.
Catch yourself. And I was like,
take a moment to breathe.
Yeah, it's awesome. And then when I love that scene when Creed knocks down Drago and you hear the Rocky team, the tan 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 tan. I was like, yes. I was like, that's good. So happy. I was so happy when that happened. I was like, yes, he's down. And then you hear Nick when they get back on the ready to square off again, like tan 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 tan. I was like, oh, that's perfect. And you know, and we already covered this at the beginning, but like when Drago throws in the towel and, like, you know, willing to save his son's life, that's just perfect.
Yeah.
It's brilliant. It's really brilliant. I love it.
One thing that's really interesting about that is you notice the end of every fight in all the Rocky movies, except for Rocky 5, it always ends, the fight ends, and they play, you know, the song that that one. This one, it ends, but it's such a somber victory. I believe it does play that tune, but just a much slower... somber
like a remix
tune
of it.
Yeah,
I mean, what an ending. And what I love about the ending of this movie is ending at the graveyard, ending at Apollo's grave. I thought it was such like a, again, another one of those ones where it's like, this could have been the end. This could have been, they could have been like, we're doing just Creed and Creed 2, we're finished, because it's like, he made amends with his father, he defended the family name against the family that killed his father, and he's got his daughter, he's got Bianca, Rocky fixed things up with Robert, and he meets, was that kid CGI? Because he looked like a little Talia Shire.
Yes, and he said that. He said, you look just like his grandma, or you look just like his mother. I'm just like, holy shit, that kid does look like Talia Shire. I was going to bring that up. I'm glad you did.
And it's like, it's almost a shock that we're going to be getting a Creed 3 directed by Michael B. Jordan, I guess.
Yeah,
so
his directorial debut.
Interesting. So it'll be interesting to see what they do with it.
I don't know what that's going to happen, but like, I can't wait to see what they bring. I really can't wait, because we're at the end. There's like no Rocky-related movies until whatever Michael B. Jordan does, and like, I just can't wait to see what the hell happens, man. I really can't wait. And this has been like one of the most interesting, like I don't really like sports movies. I really like, it's not my favorite genre. Like, I'd rather watch a romance movie, but like, I love the Rock.
Well,
It's awesome.
Well, for me, it's like I honestly don't even consider any of the Rocky movies sports movies because it's not about the fight. It's about the characters and the trials they go through, and it's all sort of embodied in the fight.
I mean, it's about human perseverance and like you know, going the distance and you know doing everything you can, and like all these movies, including Five, I really they're like some very heartwarming moments, and I'm so glad I watched all of these. So yeah. Yep. I mean, like, that's it. I mean, like, I can't wait for Rocky 3 whenever the hell it comes out. That's
going to be awesome. 3? Rocky 3 came out a while ago.
Creed 3.
No, I know. Yeah, I'm excited for whenever that happens. I mean, it was just announced recently, so we've still got... I mean, we're looking at... Whenever it happens, we're looking at probably a late 2022, 2023 probably. Release. So we got a long time, sadly, but... It'll be good seeing everyone come back, and it'll be a wonder. I mean, I don't think Stallone will come back. I mean, he basically said his goodbye, didn't he?
I think
when he
so.
Was like, "Hey, kid, the show is yours now, or this is yours."
Yeah.
No,
I just wonder. Fist bump. Yeah.
Well, no. After the fight, when Rocky was standing outside the ring, and he didn't get in the ring with Donnie, and he was just like, "You're like, it's all you now," and he just like sat down. It's like I was like, "All right, I guess that's." I guess Stallone is done with the Creed series.
Yep.
So we'll see. But yeah, so that wraps up Rocky Month, everybody. As usual, we're going to do our ranking. We're going to have our rankings. Those will be coming out in a few days. And this is another month where we've got just one more day on the book, one more Sunday on the books. So next week, we got something special. For you. We were like, it was another one where Santino and I were like, we gotta pick something that's like, there's only two movies that we can talk about. And we're like, we probably should have done this in October because it's picking up with horror, but we don't care. And I don't know about you guys, I am excited as hell to talk about these two movies. Next Sunday, we're talking The Shining versus Dr. Sleep. So this is gonna be great because I love both of those movies to death. So it'll be us three, and we got one more person who's going to be joining us. So it'll be a nice roundtable conversation of both of those movies. So make sure you guys come back and tune in for that. Like I said, in a few days, we got a ranking episode coming out. We're going to go through. All three of us are going to rank the movies, what we thought of them. And we're almost done with November. Where did this month go? So guys, thanks for tuning in. I'm Chad. Have a good night.
Santino signing off.
And I'm Ken. Take it easy, everyone.